Inshallah, we will be reading from verse number 1 of Surah Al-Ghashiyah, page number 631 of the Sahih International Translation.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم هل أتاك حديث الغاشية وجوه يومئذ خاشعة عاملة ناصبة تصلى نارا حامية تسقى من عين آنية ليس لهم طعام إلا من ضريع لا يسمن ولا يغني من جوع وجوه يومئذ ناعمة لسعيها راضية في جنة عالية لا تسمع فيها لاغية فيها عين جارية فيها سرر مرفوعة وأكواب موضوعة ونمارق مصفوفة وزرابي مبثوثة أفلا ينظرون إلى الإبل كيف خلقت وإلى السماء كيف رفعت وإلى الجبال كيف نصبت وإلى الأرض كيف سطحت فذكر إنما أنت مذكر لست عليهم بمسيطر إلا من تولى وكفر فيعذبه الله العذاب الأكبر إن إلينا إيابهم ثم إن علينا حسابهم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والفجر وليال عشر والشفع والوتر والليل إذا يسري هل في ذلك قسم لذي حجر ألم تر كيف فعل ربك بعاد إرم ذات العماد التي لم يخلق مثلها في البلاد وثمود الذين جابوا الصخر بالواد وفرعون ذي الأوتاد الذين طغوا في البلاد فأكثروا فيها الفساد فصب عليهم ربك سوط عذاب إن ربك لبالمرصاد فأما الإنسان إذا ما ابتلاه ربه فأكرمه ونعمه فيقول ربي أكرمن وأما إذا ما ابتلاه فقدر عليه رزقه فيقول ربي أهانن كلا بل لا تكرمون اليتيم ولا تحاضون على طعام المسكين وتأكلون التراث أكلا لما وتحبون المال حبا جما كلا إذا دكت الأرض دكا دكا وجاء ربك والملك صفا صفا وجيء يومئذ بجهنم يومئذ يتذكر الإنسان وأنى له الذكرى يقول يا ليتني قدمت لحياتي فيومئذ لا يعذب عذابه أحد ولا يوثق وثاقه أحد يا أيها أيتها النفس المطمئنة ارجعي إلى ربك راضية مرضية فادخلي في عبادي وادخلي جنتي.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. All praise is due to Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every member of his household, all his companions. May Allah bless them all and bless every single one of us. Ameen. My beloved mothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have just completed the days of takbir, the days of Eid. They are also known as Ayyamut Tashriq, the days where we were reading that takbir after the farad salah, every single farad salah. So we thank Allah for that beautiful opportunity, and also we ask Allah to make us from those whose sins have been forgiven and who can start a new leaf. Ameen. My mothers and sisters, these verses, or the first surah that I read, Suratul Ghashiyah, it is very, very scary, to put it that way. Scary in the sense that we all do deeds and we would like to hope that these deeds are accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But in these verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is explaining how some people's deeds are wasted for certain reasons. So they do good deeds, but when they do good deeds, those deeds will not be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for various reasons. So the term al-ghashiyah, it means the overwhelming. One of the names of the day of resurrection, al-ghashiyah, the overwhelming. It will definitely cover everyone. Everyone will be so bothered about their own that in the world they had a lot of time to talk about everyone else but themselves. And when it comes to the day of judgment, it's the total opposite. We will not have a moment to talk about others. But if we were from those who were bothered about ourselves in this world, then on the day of judgment, Allah will save us from being too worried about ourselves as well. So the first verse, Allah says, هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ الْغَاشِيَةِ, has there reached you the report of the overwhelming event? What is the overwhelming event? The day of judgment. So in other words, has the information or the news or the report of the day of judgment reached you, the day that will be overwhelming? The second verse, some faces on that day will be humbled. Some faces on that day will be humbled. The third verse, working hard and exhausted. They will look as though they are exhausted. They were working hard and they are exhausted. They did a lot of deeds during the worldly life, which did not benefit them since they were not accompanied by faith, or they were not done for the sake of Allah, but they were done for other reasons. And this is why we go back to the original teaching of Islam. That which distinguishes Islam from all other religions is that any act of worship that we do should have been taught by the messenger who was sent to us with the message to teach us how to worship the one who made us, number one. Number two is it should be done only and solely for the sake of our maker. So those are the two conditions of acceptance of deeds when you do deeds. When we talk about deeds here, we're talking about acts of worship. So if you do salah, it needs to be done in accordance with the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and for the sake of Allah. If those two conditions are met, inshallah, it will be acceptable and it will not go to waste. But for a person who does it without the correct proper way, they do deeds as per their whims and fancies, or whatever they've witnessed their forefathers doing, or someone comes up with something Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not teach, and they decide we want to do this act of worship, and you know, we want to slap our cheeks when someone passes away, or we want to hit our chest when someone passes away, thinking that it's going to reduce their punishment because we are punishing ourselves on their behalf. That is foolish. Nothing's going to happen of that nature. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. If a person wants to read a type of salah that Allah has not revealed through his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that salah will be rejected because it is an innovation. For example, a man who wants to fulfill prayer standing on his hands, that is absolutely unacceptable if he considers it one of the five daily prayers, or he considers it an act of worship for the sake of Allah, wanted and requested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Obviously, dua is supplication. It is also termed as prayer in the English language, but dua, you and I know, is different from salah. When it comes to dua or supplication, you can call out to Allah at any time, every time, any words, any language, whatever you wish. But when it comes to salah, there is a difference. You need to do it the way the Prophet ﷺ taught. He was the messenger. That's the word, messenger, rasul. Rasul means sent by someone with a message. What is the message? Well, it's primarily in the Quran and thereafter in the sunnah of Muhammad ﷺ. Simple to understand, yet takes a lifetime to fulfill and a lot of dedication to fulfill. So Allah says there will be some faces that would have worked hard and they will be exhausted. They will enter, listen to this, they will enter to burn in an intensely hot fire. Allahu Akbar. They will enter into the hot fire. Why? They did a lot of good deeds. Sometimes those deeds were wasted in another way. What is another way? Another way is you did a lot of good deeds. Yes, you did them correctly as per the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And yes, they were done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then you stole when it comes to the rights of other human beings. So you might have deceived this one, cheated this one, perhaps spread rumor about that one, gossiped about this one, etc. So what happened? Your salah went to this person, your zakah went to that person, your acts of worship went to a whole lot of people. And when you come on the day of judgment, mashallah, you come with a very tired face because you did a lot of deeds in this world, but you realize that, wow, I've wasted all these deeds because they've been given to everyone here and there. This is why, my mothers and sisters, it's important to protect your good deeds once you do them by not bothering or not engaging negatively in the lives of others. You want to engage in the lives of others? Do so positively. Talk good about them. Say nice things. Help them. Make dua for them. Say something positive. If you have to help them too, help them in a positive way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive every one of us. Ameen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says they will be given drink from a boiling spring. Now obviously this is all description of hellfire and that time, the life after death, for those who have not qualified. May Allah forgive us. Remember, it's never too late to seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islam is a religion based on the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are warnings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But He has always taught us that these warnings, they should be making people seek forgiveness and repent and become better. When they become better, their lives will improve to begin with, and thereafter, their hereafter, which is eternal, will actually improve as well. So when Allah describes how people will be burnt in the hot fire and how they will be given hot drink, boilings from the boiling spring to drink, when we hear this, it should make us say, Astaghfirullah, O Allah, I seek your forgiveness, I repent to you, I turn to you. The bad I've done, Ya Allah, I require your mercy, please forgive me, etc. I won't do it again, I'll try my best to be the best of people, bearing in mind that the rules and regulations of Islam are actually pure, good, and they will result in your success. Allah did not reveal rules in order for us to become distressed. Rather, it's the other way around. Those who follow a sinful way of life will be more depressed than those who follow a disciplined way of life for the sake of Allah. And in the hereafter, there is no question about that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness in this world and the next. So Allah says, they will be made to drink from a boiling spring. For them, there will be no food except from poisonous thorny plant, which neither nourishes nor avails against hunger. Now Allah is warning the people to say, don't do bad deeds, don't waste your deeds, don't do deeds for anyone besides Allah. Here we're talking of acts of worship. And don't do any acts of worship that were not taught by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How would He have taught them? Through the messengers that He sent. The messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with the Quran, and it was obviously detailed by the sunnah, by his entire lifestyle. So we adopt that, and we understand that the ulama have busied themselves trying to explain to us, not for nothing, but for a particular reason. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this a means of our entry into Jannah. Ameen. So Allah says, other faces. Now obviously, you know, everyone becomes worried. If you notice, I'm actually trying to word it in a way that people don't worry so much. May Allah forgive us all. Because it's very, very serious. These verses are absolutely serious. They're very scary, like I said, because it shows that you can do deeds. And if there's something wrong, it will be a waste. It's like sending $100,000 to a bank account somewhere and you make a mistake with one little digit. It's your fault. I mean, you should have checked it, rechecked it, rechecked it, and got someone else to check it and make sure that the money got to the right bank account. There we are. So with us, we make a mistake of one digit. Allah says, be careful, be careful. All your deeds will go into the wrong account. Allahu Akbar. Did you hear that example? So when you start doing good deeds, but you've wronged someone else, it means one digit in your deeds is wrong. And what is it? The protection of those deeds. You didn't protect them. Instead of 35844, you actually typed 35845. What happened? It went to someone else's bank account somewhere well beyond your reach. May Allah forgive us. So we need to protect our deeds. Thereafter, once Allah says things that are filled with warning, He says things that are filled with hope as well. Listen to what He says. Other faces on that day will show pleasure. May Allah make us from those. Ameen. Other faces on that day will show pleasure. With their effort, they are satisfied in an elevated garden wherein they will hear no unsuitable speech. They protected themselves from unsuitable speech in the world. Allah will protect them from unsuitable speech in the hereafter. You go into Jannah, you're not going to hear screaming, shouting, yelling, distress, people in pain. No more. It's all over and it's gone. So Allah says, those who did good deeds and they were satisfied with their deeds, they will be in elevated gardens wherein they will hear no unsuitable speech. Within it is a flowing spring. Within it are couches raised high and cups put up in a place. Subhanallah. The cups will be put up in place. In what type of a place? Places that will be pleasing to those who will look at them, to those who will use them, etc. Allah says, and there will be cushions lined up and carpets spread around. What type of cushions? Well, we need to get there to see, but definitely not even from the best of the cushions of this world, because everything in this world is actually created from the earth or what is derived from it. Allahu Akbar. Carpets, what type of carpets? Well, we've got to wait and look at those carpets. See, inshallah, do good deeds and Allah will show you. Allah will show you in this world and the next. So Allah says, then do they not look at the camels? Now, after Allah speaks about all of these things in 16 verses, He then draws our attention to His signs. The fact that He exists. The fact that whatever you see here is not a coincidence as some happen to think. The fact that whatever you see on earth was actually created by a maker, designed by Him in a specific way for several reasons, for many reasons. Some we know, some we may never know. So Allah says, then do they not look at the camels, how they are created? So Allah is encouraging us all to go and study the camel. My mothers and sisters, you can check it out on YouTube. You can Google it. You can see. You'll be fulfilling this instruction of Allah. Go and see what the camel is all about. You'll be surprised how it can go, what type of water it holds, how much it can travel. Why is it that that's mainly in the desert and so on? Why do you not find camels in some other places? How was it created? How does it eat? What about its milk? What are the nutrients in its milk? And so on. And what is the benefit of its meat? And everything else. Go and learn. Go and learn. Allah says, will they not look at the camels, how they are created? Go and see it. Go and check. The hump, what's it all about? Why camels? Why does Allah create camels? And why does He want us to go into the lives or into how it was made? Why does He specify camels? Then He says, and the sky, how it was raised. How it was raised. Allah is encouraging you to go into the skies and beyond in study. Go and study. You will be amazed by the number of planets that you find, galaxies you find, so many things that you find. And every day they are discovering new stars. They call them stars, new planets. That which is far bigger than anything they ever saw in the past. Wallahi, my sisters, I'm not joking with you. Every single day they are discovering new stars. They are looking. Go and check it out. You will see how insignificant and small you are. They say the nearest star is 4.5 light years away. The nearest one. I'm talking of these little stars. 4.5 light years. If light, at the speed of light, if you were to travel for 4.5 years, then you would get to the first star. But none of us can travel at the speed of light. What that means is, when you see a star up in the heavens, it was there 4.5 years ago. It may not be there today. When you see a star, what we say, falling, it fell 4.5 years ago, minimum. I'm talking of only the closest one. The others, 10 years, 20 years, 50 years, 100 years, 100 light years away, whatever. So, you know what? It must have fallen in another lifetime. But We're only seeing it now, and man still thinks it's a big deal. He wants to steal and usurp, and he wants to go against the commands of Allah, and he wants to make this one's life difficult and swear about that one and backbite about this one and do this about that one and do all sorts of dirty, nasty things, not realizing, man, you're only here for 70 years. That's it. After that, gone, like everyone else went. Your forefathers were stronger than you, perhaps more good looking than you and I, but we don't even know their names. May Allah forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. There will come a time when people won't know our names either. No one. And we think we're a big deal. We want to go against the laws of Allah and think that it's not going to harm us. It's going to probably harm Allah. Well, how? How? Or we forget Allah. We have no option but to go back to Him. So just make peace with Him. That's all. You know, I read a story, and this is something amazing, where they say there was a man who committed a crime and he was one of the ministers of a certain king. So the king decides to send him to the dogs. So he told the king, can you just give me 1 week? And in a week's time, you can send me to the dogs. Now, they used to have a big enclosure where people who did bad deeds were sent in to the dogs and they were mauled and literally killed by those dogs, wild dogs. So what he did is, the king says, okay, I'll give you a week. He went to the guy who was the gatekeeper there where the dogs. He said, can I be the gatekeeper for 1 week? And the guy says, but why? He says, nah, just take off. Just take leave for 1 week. So the guy goes to this particular place, enclosure, and every day he goes in, he feeds the dogs, he made peace with them, he plays with them, and he actually, developed a relationship with them, taking food to them, cleaning them, washing them, and whatever else was needed to be done was done. A week later, this man came back, the other one went, and the king decides, right, you go into the enclosure. As he's thrown into the enclosure, the public who were there, came to see and witness. They were shocked. Why? Because these dogs started wagging their tails and they were excited. Ooh, the guy's here and so on. Nothing happened. Now, my mothers and sisters, why am I telling you this? I'm telling you this to you because man can think when it comes to a wild animal that's going to harm him, that if I could make peace with it, let me make peace with it. Please don't try and make peace with the lions at the cheetah park here, please. You know? So, what happened? The man was saved. Now, this is nowhere near the example of Allah. Allah is merciful, Ghafurur Rahim. He will forgive you. But all He is saying is, make peace with Allah. That's it. Seek forgiveness. Turn your bad ways and habits. And Allah is not asking you to go and feed Him. Nor is Allah asking you for anything else. But man is scared of a wild animal. And he's scared of a dog. And nowadays, men, or children, let's say, are scared of mosquitoes. They're scared of little insects. Notice I changed the gender. Then I went to the children. May Allah forgive us. But that's what happens. We're frightened of small little flies that sit on us. Ooh, green fly. Come on, green fly, yellow fly, blue fly. You're worried about the fly more than you're worried about Allah. It's a reality. Worried about cholera. You know, now we had this sacrifice, right? I'm sure everyone's seen a green fly. Subhanallah. It just came to say, Salaam alaikum. That's it. And we were frightened. We were irritated. We thought of things. We went to buy sprays perhaps. You know, people taught us of how to put water into plastic bags and hang them by your windows. By the way, that works. And so on. But what about Allah? Allah says, no, you know what? There's a fire there, man. Just protect yourself. Wear some uniform that is fireproof. What's the fireproof uniform? Salah. Just dress appropriately. Just come to me. Just do good deeds. Just stop talking rubbish about people. Just lead your own life. Worry about yourself, your business, and so on. Don't steal, usurp. You know the rules. That's how you create a fireproofing. That's what Allah says. Wow, beautiful example. My mothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for helping us and guiding us through these beautiful verses of the Quran. So Allah says, why don't they look at the camel? They will see. They will see. Look at the skies. How was the sky raised? And at the mountains, how were they erected? The mountains, imagine, have you thought of the mountains? What are they there for? What's inside them? Why did Allah make mountains? Go and research. How many of us have done this homework? In fact, we wouldn't even know that these verses existed that Allah is telling us, go and see these things. Study the camel. And nowadays, it's a Google away. Google. We will Google about how to apply henna, subhanallah, on our hands. And how to make cakes and where to take the kids and so on. We'll Google about it, subhanallah. Her shoes, we'll Google about them. We'll actually buy things online as well. But when it comes to things the Quran, your maker has asked you to look into, and it's just a little click away. And we haven't yet done that. Why? Because we didn't know. Well, now you know. So please, let's try and do something about it. At least one of these four things. Then Allah says, what about the earth? Let them look at the earth and how we spread it out. We spread the earth out. So Allah says thereafter, so remind, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you are only a reminder, which means you are only a person who reminds. You are only the messenger who will remind. That's it. Remind. Keep on reminding them. You're the reminder. You are not a controller over them. You're just a reminder. So remind. The same applies to us in a different way. Obviously, we are not messengers. We are not the best of creation. We are not flawless people. But we have to remind each other. That's why we're sitting here today. May Allah reward all of us. All of us. Everyone who made an effort. Everyone who's going to be listening to this later on as well. May Allah reward you all and all those who made it possible. Subhanallah. Then Allah says, you are not over them, O controller. However, he who turns away and disbelieves, then Allah will punish him with the greatest punishment. Indeed, to us is their return. They don't realize that they have no option but to return to us. Everyone before them has already returned to us. They are going to come. Why do they think that they are greater than us? Yes, they may have achieved. They may be big people in terms of the dunya and this worldly life. But they can never be bigger than their maker. No ways. They need to humble themselves to their maker. Because Allah says they are going to return to us. We know. There's no way but to come back to us. They will be cornered. And they will have nowhere to go. Wherever they go, they will meet their Lord. So Allah says, indeed to us is their return. Then indeed upon us is their account. We will take account of their deeds. May Allah make it easy for every one of us the day He takes account of our deeds. We move on to the next surah. My dearest mothers and sisters, that surah is Al-Fajr. A salah that a lot don't read. Allahu Akbar. Surah Al-Fajr. Al-Fajr is actually referring here to the dawn. The dawn. I know it's the name of a salah, but here it's referring to the dawn. And Allah swears an oath by the dawn. Allah says, Wal-Fajr. By the dawn. Allah is the only one allowed to take an oath by anything besides Him. With all of us, we're not allowed to take an oath except by Him, His names, His qualities. That's it. Man kana halifan falyahlif billahi. Whoever's going to take an oath, take an oath by Allah. So I can say by Allah, by the words of Allah, by the signs of Allah, by the names of Allah, by the one who hears, and so on and so forth. But I cannot say anything besides that. It's Allah who's allowed to say by the dawn. And by the 10 nights, Allah swears by the 10 nights. Wow, what are those 10 nights? Why does Allah swear an oath by 10 nights? What's the big deal? Allahu Akbar. When Allah only swears oaths by that which is grand and great. So Allah says, by the 10 nights, for your information, my mothers and sisters, those are the 10 nights that have just passed now, the first 10 nights of Dhul-Hijjah. Soon as you see the moon, that's the first night. Allahu Akbar. So you have 10 nights. Allah swears an oath by those 10 nights. Why? The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Ma min ayyamin al-amalu as-salihu feehinna ahabba ila Allah min hadhihi al-ashr." There are no days better. There are no days more loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for good deeds to be done in than these first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. So Allah swears by their nights, the month of Dhul-Hijjah. Then Allah says, and by the even number and the odd. By the even number and the odd. The numbers. Imagine if there were no numbers. How would we count? Allahu Akbar. You know, these things are taken for granted. They are literally taken for granted. We've never thought of it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. What are we doing? We're counting numbers. Numbers. So things are even. Things are odd. Amazing how Allah has created these numbers. Have you thought of odd numbers? Subhanallah. If we sit and think about it, it's mind-boggling. But we take it for granted because we go to school and we learn one. In fact, before we go to school, we already learn 1, 2, 3. Allah says, and by the night when it passes. How does the night pass? Have you thought about it? Why did Allah swear an oath by the night when it passes? Subhanallah. It's actually a rotation of the earth, the sun, the moon, everything going around in a huge galaxy as described in other verses of the Quran. And Allah says, the day and the night, yukawwiru al-layla ala al-nahar wa yukawwiru al-nahara ala al-layl. You know, that term yukawwir, it has in it the idea of roundness also. So it goes round. The day goes round and enters into the night, and the night goes round and enters into the day. That's what the Quran says. Allahu Akbar. Science discovered that later on. When the night is long, the day is short. When the day is long, the night is short, and so on. What's happening? It's just Allah. Imagine if there was no night. What would happen? Some places on earth, the night happens to come very, very rare, meaning after a long, long time. But most places on earth, it's not like that. So Allah says, and by the night when it passes, then Allah says something important. Normally he takes all these oaths when there is something very, very important that he wants to say. So Allah says, وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ وَالشَّفْعِ وَالْوَتْرِ وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَسْرِ هَلْ فِي ذَلِكَ قَسَمٌ لِذِي حِجْرٍ. Is there not in all that an oath sufficient for the one of perception, the one who understands? So if you read the footnote, it says, based upon the following verses, what has been sworn by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that He will certainly punish the disbelievers. That's what He says. Allah says, I take an oath. Is there not in all of this a sufficient enough oath for those who perceive, for those who know, for those who understand? Have you not considered how your Lord dealt with Ad? Subhanallah. Ad, the previous nation, the nation of Hud alayhi salam, Allah says, didn't you see the nation of Ad with Iram? What was Iram? Another name for the first people of Ad, whom the Prophet Hud was sent to. They had lofty pillars, Dhatil Imad. They had lofty pillars, very, very tall pillars, skyscraping pillars. Today we have skyscraping buildings. There they had one pillar, and they were huge people as well. And Allah says, we destroyed them. Don't they see? Have you not considered how your Lord has dealt with these previous nations of Ad? Who had lofty pillars, the likes of whom had never been created in the land. Never. Those were the first. We destroyed them, Allah says. When they disbelieved, we destroyed them. What about Thamud? Allah says in the next verse, and with Thamud, who carved out the rocks in the valley. They literally carved out the rocks, and they could do it with their hands, according to some narrations. Imagine. Allah says, what about the Pharaoh, Fir'aun, the Al-Awtad, the owner of all the stakes? Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Fir'aun adhil awtad. Let them think of the Pharaoh. He used to kill the boys, if you remember. He used to kill a lot of people. He did a lot on land. Allah says, wait, there came a time. We let him do his thing for a while, and then we destroyed him. Same applies to all the tyrants and oppressors and anyone. The same applies to you and I. If we oppress someone, Allah will allow you a certain period of time to write it against your name or for whatever reason He knows best. And after that, don't worry. Your return is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says, do they not consider Ad, Thamud, Fir'aun, all of whom oppressed within the lands and increased corruption on the land? Allah says, so your Lord poured upon them a whole lot of punishment. Different types of punishment. Indeed, your Lord is in observation. He knows. Now these are comforting verses, and at the same time, they are a warning. Comforting for those who are being oppressed to say, hang on, Allah is observing. Allah is watching. Allah knows. Allah is all powerful. Allah allows things to happen for many reasons, you know. Subhanallah. Every time it's a reason. We don't know it. Allah knows it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, your Lord poured upon them punishment. Indeed, your Lord is in observation. He's watching. And as for man, man is strange. What does man do? Allah says, when his Lord tries him and is generous to him and favors him, he says, my Lord has honored me. So that's man. When Allah gives human beings things, they become proud rather than grateful. And they attribute the favor to themselves. Now listen to this. It's something strange. When Allah gives us, we start becoming big-headed. Allahu Akbar. This is why it's important to measure your head every single night and make sure the inches are not increasing. Because when your head becomes big, Allahu Akbar, it's a sign that you are not really grateful to Allah. You're not. A person who's been given everything, but they are so humble, they are really beautiful people going out to reach out to those who perhaps don't have. Their character is refined thereafter, becomes even better, because now they're wealthy, now they've got. Those are the ones who are grateful to Allah. Those who become closer to Allah when they have. A lot of the times, people who start becoming wealthy turn away from Allah. They start doing things they wouldn't have believed they would have done. Sometimes they start dressing inappropriately. Sometimes they start going to inappropriate places. Sometimes they start eating inappropriately. Sometimes their behavior becomes inappropriate. Sometimes they start abandoning their duties unto Allah. But true believers, don't ever let that affect them. Like Allah gave you, He can take it away. When He gives you, He tries, He tests you. When He takes it away, it's another test. That's why Allah says, as for man, when Allah tests him by giving him. Did you hear that? فَأَمَّا الْإِنسَانُ إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَأَكْرَمَهُ وَنَعَمَهُ. As for man, when Allah tests him by giving him and by granting him from his favors, then he says, oh, my Lord favored me, but he means that, you know what, I got it. Be from amongst those who truly thank Allah. Then Allah says, so when he's given, he's arrogant and proud. And when it's taken away from him, he says, oh, my Lord is letting me down. You know, I don't want to worship Allah anymore because, hey, I'm struggling, suffering, and Allah's not listening to me. Well, you've got no option. You go call out to Allah, understand your test. Perhaps there's a reason why Allah's keeping things away from you. So Allah says, verse number 16, but when he tries him by restricting his provision, he says, my Lord has humiliated me. Imagine a person is wealthy, they bought their Mercedes. This is why this morning I was chatting with a friend of mine. Mashallah, this friend of mine has actually, from a different country altogether, made a little bit of money. And I said to this friend, listen, do me a favor. I'm sure you're going to change your motor vehicle now, but don't go for the kill. Do you know what that means? You don't need the most expensive, most luxurious car ever. You don't need that. Just go for another vehicle that's decent. It will get you along. And mashallah, it has a name that people, when they look at it, they realize, yes, it's comfortable. Yes, it's perhaps luxurious. But you don't need to jump suddenly from a 1960 Corolla all the way to, you know, a 2017, perhaps, let me not say the names of the cars, but okay, let's say a name, Tesla. Okay, there it goes. You don't need to jump from there to there. You can, but you don't need to. Why? Hang on, Allah's just given you something. He might take it away as quickly as He gave it to you. Then what's going to happen? Are you going to be able to downgrade your life? Are you really going to be able to downgrade? A lot of us do things we cannot afford, and we live our lives without prioritizing, and we don't realize we're spending money where we did not need to spend it, and then we complain of being poor. I give you a simple example. If you cannot afford a private school, take your child out of there. Simple as 1, 2, 3. But no, you know what? The Joneses send their kids there, so I need to send my kids there as well. That's the problem. You're not poor. You don't know how to prioritize. You really don't. No, I want to give my child this and that. Well, hang on. You're living beyond your means. You're struggling, you're suffering. Your child will get the best education, but the pressure that you've put on your husband within the marriage might break it and ruin it. Why should the child grow up in a broken home? Take the child out of there. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. It's happening. It's happening in our own country a lot, a lot. People cannot afford it, but they're doing it. Why? Just because they're too ashamed of, or they are justifying it in any other way. Don't. There are schools, go and look. The results are top at government schools as well. If you can't afford it, you can't afford it. Be humble enough to say, I can't afford it. It's done. You'll be a happier person. Like I said, a lot of us want to live a life far beyond we can actually afford. Allah says, I gave you. Come on, I gave you. You're wasting it, man. You're spending it. You're not prioritizing. You've got enough to survive. There are people who don't even have that. Come on. So this is the verse. Allah is saying, when I give them, they have a problem. When I take away from them, they have a problem. So when is man ever thankful? So then Allah says in the next verse, no, but you are not. You do not honor the orphan. You don't even reach out to others. You don't honor the orphans. You don't look after people in need. That's the problem. And Allah says in the next verse, and you do not encourage one another to feed the poor. That's another problem. You're just feeding yourselves. That's what it is. You want more and more and more until you're eating that which is so unhealthy, but because it's very expensive and it's nice and everyone who's on a certain level of finance is eating out at that particular place, so you have to go there. Otherwise, you're not going to talk to him or he's not going to talk to you for however long, depending on who is the breadwinner. And then Allah says, and you consume inheritance. Consuming inheritance meaning you are cheating people out of their wealth, of the estate of the deceased, whether it's women or children or men or anyone else. The executors who are cheating, Allah says, hang on, we're watching. We're an observation. Don't you remember the previous verse? Allah says, we're watching. So you stole $10 million. So what happened? Yes, you stole it. The people who you stole it from are living a more content life than you are. And guess what? When you die, your children are going to kill each other for that $10 million. Go give it away. Give it back to who it belongs to. Don't be ashamed. Even if it is two generations down, take it and go to those people and say, look, my grandfather stole from the estate of our great-grandfather. I'm returning it to you. So Allah forgives me. I don't think people can do that unless they have iman, unless they are really worried about the akhirah. The rest of them, they will amass millions and billions, and guess what? They're just 10 people in the house, 5 people in the house. Where is that wealth going to go? That's what Allah is saying in these verses. You consume inheritance. تَأْكُلُونَ التُّرَاثَ أَكْلًا لَمَّنْ. You devour it all together. You just swipe it. That's it. Gone. What happened? This is inheritance. So you cheated the girls. You cheated the mothers. You cheated the sisters. You cheated the brothers. You cheated those who were perhaps less powerful. You cheated those who didn't have that much access to that wealth. And it's gone. So Allah says, that's what you did. And you love wealth immensely. You know, the word is, وَتُحِبُّونَ الْمَالَ حُبًّا جَمًّا. The word love is used twice there. You love wealth with immense love. That's what Allah says. That's a problem. So these are problems Allah is speaking about. Difficulties, negativities, bad things. Allah says, you don't feed the orphans. You don't reach out to those in need. You don't feed the poor. You don't encourage each other to feed the poor. When it comes to giving, you give minimum, very, very minimum, very little. And you give the worst. You know, you sacrifice your animal. The trotters and the intestines will go to the poor. The rest is mine. Okay, fair enough. Maybe it's a third. Yeah, it's gone. But don't you have a heart to give one nice big back leg to some poor people? Allahu Akbar. I hope I didn't press a red button there. If your ears are twitching, please go to your freezer. Take a little bit out and give it, inshallah. Obviously, it's all said with a lot of love, mashallah. This is all said with a lot of love. It's said to myself, my own family to begin with, and then to everyone else. But things have to be said sometimes. We need to think about things. So Allah says, subhanallah, no, no. You know, after he says you love wealth with immense love, not realizing that it's not going to really get you anywhere unless you've spent it in the right way. So Allah says, no. When the earth has been leveled, pounded and crushed, and your Lord has come, and the angels rank upon rank, they all come and brought within view is the day. On the day is hell. It's brought within view. That day man will remember. He will remember. What will he remember? Everything that happened. He will remember, ooh, I should have done this. I should have done that. I should have honored the orphans. I should have encouraged and I should have spent on the poor and so on. Looked after the widows and the orphans and everyone else. And I should have and I should have. But too late. Allah says on that day when everything is brought forward and he will think to himself, but how, what good to him will be the remembrance on that day? How will that remembrance help him? Think of it now. On that day when you say, oh, I remember everything. Allah says, well, to remember it now is a waste of time. He will say, oh, I wish that I had sent ahead some good for my life so that now it would have benefited me. I wish, Allah says, so on that day, none will punish and severe as severely as Allah's punishment. And none will bind as severely as his binding of the evildoers. To the righteous it will be said, and now obviously after hearing such severe verses, immediately Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, to the righteous, to those who are trying, to those who seek forgiveness, to those who are spending, to those who don't cheat others, to those who are loving and caring, to animals and human beings, all of them, Allah says, Allah will say to them, or it will be said to them, O reassured soul, return to your Lord, well pleased and pleasing to Allah, and enter amongst my righteous servants, enter my paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all entry into Jannatul Firdaus. And may Allah forgive us. May Allah make us from the righteous. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us in every single way. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us a means of goodness. May Allah use us to spread the goodness, to encourage people to do good, to be able to live our lives according to the means that Allah has bestowed upon us, to be thankful and show gratitude through obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah bless you all and bless every one of us. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad.